Three levels, six stages. How do you know what's right and wrong? How do you know what's good and bad? Is that just assumed? Everybody who gets to the adult phase just wants to go, well, you know what's right. Everybody knows what's right. But do they know what's right? It depends on where you are in this world, where you're born, and whom you're born to, and who does the raising, and who does the shaping, and what level of responsibility as an adult you take for shaping your own from that point on. So now we got three levels. They're pretty straightforward, thus they're fairly easy to remember. And we've got six stages, two in each level. So it's just a sequence that unfolds where we develop a sense of right and wrong, where Kohlberg was critiqued by Carol Gilligan and others for having a slant that was predominantly male, valuing male traits in a gender stereotypic fashion and really devaluing female traits in a stereotypic gender role fashion. And that's probably legit. But here is the idea. You have pre-conventional level where you're a little kid, right? Pre-conventional, that should be pretty easy to remember. If it's pre-conventional, you know what's coming next. So pre-conventional is the first stage. What do you learn in the first stage? You learn what's punished and what's rewarded. If I say, no, you can't have a cookie, and you go, okay, I'll wait. Then you go, good, that's great, way to go. You get rewarded, you get strokes, you get approval from the person that is your primary caregiver. If you have a tantrum and they flip out on you and then put you in timeout, you find out the tantrum behavior is going to be punished. So what's good is what's rewarded. What's bad is what's punished. You don't expect toddlers to have a fully developed sense of morality, right? They have to be taught right from wrong. What right and wrong is determined by the society in which they find themselves. And the people who raise them have been raised in that society, so they will typically reflect conventional values that are found within their own culture. Cultures vary across the world and across time, and people look at other cultures and say, they're crazy. They're mad or they're bad. There's something wrong with them. But had you grown up in that culture, you would have thought the reverse to be true, because that would have been your worldview. And what you're critiquing from this worldview would seem normal, and this would seem unusual. The conventional level is the good boy, good girl orientation, where we start talking about those the Erikson levels, right? The stages you went through where you develop a sense of self. You start off with the world operating on you. And if you get enough good boy, that's awesome, you're a great girl. Hey, you're an awesome kid, I love you. Then you have the sense developing internally that you are good. And you have a good boy, good girl orientation. Or the flip side of that, if you get punished a lot, right? You're always bad and I knew you was going to be up to something because that's the kind of kid you are. Then you get this sense developing that there must be something bad about you, a bad boy, bad girl orientation. I once saw some parents back in the soccer realm when I was coaching or sitting on the sidelines as a parent, and this set of parents had a kid on the team. They also had a little kid, and they go, man, he's mean. He's 2.5. He's mean as a snake, or 3 or whatever he was. He was running around, so he must have been older than 2. Mean as a snake. He threw stuff at his brother the other day. And then I saw the little kid starts just grab the side of this, it was the chain link fence, and he's just jerking on it, banging, and they're like, look, ain't he mean? Ain't he? Well, what was he hearing over and over? You're mean, you're bad, you're violent, you're aggressive, you, and nobody's intervening that I can see to actually change the outcome. So it makes sense that this kid is going to see himself as a tough kid, a bad boy, who's probably going to then interact with his peers in a manner very much consistent with what he'd heard over and over up to the point that he developed a sense of self that would be consistent with what the world is giving him in terms of feedback. Well, we all learn that you're going to be able to do some things and not be able to do other things. Those things you're not able to do, authority says you can't do. There's the rules. Rules, you violate the rules, you get thrown out of the game, or you get penalized. You violate society's big rules, you go to jail. We call those big rules laws. So you learn in school and at home that rules are there by virtue of authority. And you got kids that then fall in line with that and say, well, I do it because I'm supposed to do it because those are the rules. And those kids would be your good girl, good boy oriented kids, right? And then you got the other kids who are going to flaunt the rules. Those who are going to break the rules find it a little bit of a game to get around the rules, right? Because they're anti-authority. But the idea is that you realize there's a set of rules and you're motivated either to follow the rules or the flip side, to get around the rules. Well, that's the conventional level. That's what people typically operate at. Post-conventional level, we now move up in our moral thinking and our moral reasoning to a different level. And Kohlberg didn't think everybody got here. He didn't think that everybody was able to reason at this higher moral level. They did what they did because they were either trained to be a good or a bad kid, and because they were either pro-authority or anti-authority, and that's how they lived their life. But you go up one more level and you start to realize that rules can be arbitrary. And that rules can be set in motion just simply to keep order. And that order can be a good thing, right? Thomas Hobbes, without rules and without government, we fall into a state of anarchy and life is nasty, brutish, and short, right? So that there's some collective gain if we all put our faith in each other to develop some social contracts that we will not kill. I won't kill you, you won't kill me. We won't steal. I won't steal from you. You won't steal from me, right? But a lot of it is just convention. So driving on the left side of the road, is that wrong or is that right?
Depends where you are.
Depends where you are. Doesn't matter whether you drive on the right-hand side of the road or the left-hand side of the road. It only matters that everybody else around you agrees, right? So you go to one culture and you're like, that's crazy, everybody's on the left-hand side of the road. They come over here and go, that's crazy, everybody's on the right-hand side of the road. But what matters is that we've all gotten together and agreed that we'll be on this side or that side. But that's a social contract, and that can change over time. Laws may be unjust. Laws may not be in the interest of some people in the society. And those people may not want to obey those laws, but they do it from a principled point of view. But if they're at that level of obeying their own conscience, now they've moved up yet one more level to the individual principle consciousness orientation. Abstract ethical principles that somebody operates on. So I may be able to reason that, yeah, well, that law's not really fair for everybody, but, you know, go with the flow, don't raise any waves, keep going and go on. So I understand it, but I don't do anything to change it. But if I put myself out there to be a target of scrutiny or vilification because I have a principle that I think is a higher principle and I want to hold to it, that's a different level. And Kohlberg would say most people don't get there, which is why you have leaders of revolutions or leaders of protests who have that as their guiding principle, and other people then see that courage exhibited and can go along with it. One interesting example I saw once on the news was in California. They had these big old culverts. I think it was LA. Big flood happened. The thing that's usually fairly empty is filled up with water and a person's being carried away down it. A citizen jumps in, grabs them, brings them to the side, and is then promptly arrested for interfering with emergency activities because the rescue people have been called and they came out there and there's nothing to do because this person just saved them. Well, you're not supposed to be swimming in there anyway, so picked him up and arrested him. And people are like, that's crazy, right? He saved the other person's life. Well, then they did what? PR got out of control. They dropped the charges because they recognized that, yes, he technically violated the law by being in there to begin with and interfering with emergency management procedures. However, the person who arrested him was operating from here, right? The authority orientation. This is the law. I'm in charge. I have to arrest you now. Somebody else went and said, oh, this is bad, right? Because they was operating here. Let's undo that outcome, because they recognized that it was not only correct to have done the action, but it also was better for the department to not arrest heroes.